Today we will be implementing a simple voting machine using Verilog. This voting machine is going to have two modes. The first one is a voting mode in which the votes will be cast for the different candidates, and the second one is the tallying mode in which the votes accumulated by every candidate can be displayed. This program was written primarily for the Z board, in particular the Zinc 7000 SoC. However, at the time of the recording, I don't have the board with me anymore, so we will have to settle for a software demonstration instead. Speaking of software, this program was primarily written using EDA Playground, which is a web-based IDE, along with some RTL images from XILINX. Now on to the main portion. This program consists of four modules: button control, mode control, vote logger, and voting machine. These three modules are combined to create the voting machine module, which is ultimately what we are trying to implement. So while making these modules, there are certain parameters that we must keep in mind. For instance, for the button control module, a button has to be pressed for a sufficient amount of time in order for the vote to be logged. It cannot simply start logging the votes the second the button is pressed. Otherwise, you can simply start logging votes by repeatedly pressing the button, which will allow multiple votes to be cast. On the other hand, once the button has been pressed for a sufficient amount of time and the vote has been logged, it must not log any votes while the button is still pressed. The vote logger module will tally the total number of votes that have been given to each candidate. It also resets its value every time a new voting operation is started. The mode control is for primarily displaying the total number of votes accumulated by the candidates or whether or not the vote has been cast. Now, we are using LEDs in this case because, as I said earlier, this program was designed for the Z board, which does not have a digital display. So I settled for using these LEDs, these eight LEDs on the Z board, to display the number of votes as well as whether or not the votes had been cast. Once a vote has been cast, all of these LEDs light up for a short time, indicating that the vote has been cast. And when the votes have to be displayed, these LEDs light up, indicating the votes in a binary fashion. So on to the next one. And this, in a nutshell, is ultimately what we are trying to accomplish. The EVM is the voting machine is first in an idle state, and then the button is pressed. We will check which mode the machine is in. If it is in mode 0, has the button been pressed for a sufficient amount of time? If yes, the vote is logged and the machine returns to its idle state. If no, then it simply returns to idle state with no vote being logged. If it is in mode 1, it will display the vote on the LEDs and then return to the idle state. Reset and the input button, which is the button that is being pressed, and it gives the output as to whether or not the vote is valid. For this purpose, we will be using this 31-bit counter as a timer to gauge for how long the button has been pressed. Now, in this always block, at every positive clock edge, if the reset is pressed, the counter resets to 0. Otherwise, if we press the button and our counter is less than 11, the counter will start incrementing until it reaches the value of 11. Now, why is this value 11? Well, I'll just get back to that. On the other hand, if the button is no longer pressed, then the counter will immediately become 0. And on to the next one. This next always block will execute in parallel to the first one. Now, if the reset is pressed, the valid vote will become 0 or low. Otherwise, if the counter is 10, the valid vote will become 1. Otherwise, it will become 0 or low. Now, it is for this purpose that this counter increments all the way up till 11. Because, for instance, if we had incremented this counter up till 10, the counter would increment until it reached 10 and then stop. In which case, this condition would become permanently true. So, the counter would The valid watt would remain high for the entire duration, and that would cause a problem as multiple watts would be locked. So this counter is instead incremented all the way up till 11 and not 10, because in this manner it will only be 10 for one clock pulse and then it will become 11. So in a similar sense, this will only be there for one pulse and then it will become low again, which will log only one single watt. The second module is the watt logger module, in which the watts given to each candidate will be tallied. For this purpose, it takes the input of the valid watt from the various button control modules and stores the total number of watts in these 8-bit registers, which correspond to the 8 LEDs. It must also take in the input of which mode the voting machine is currently in, because only in mode 0 can the vote be cast. Otherwise, in mode 1, the votes must be displayed, and as such, no increment in the vote count can take place. In the beginning, the machine is reset, and as such, all of the registers are set to 0. Now, in this block is where the voting count will be incremented. In this if-else-if sequence, once a valid vote comes in, the condition will be checked, and if the mode is 0, the candidate vote received will be incremented, increasing the count of the candidate's vote. Now, because this is an if else if condition, it creates a hierarchy, meaning that if both candidate 1 and candidate 2 receive a valid vote at the same time, candidate 1 will have their vote incremented and not candidate 2, because this is an if else if condition and the preceding condition is always checked first. So if candidate 1 valid vote is received and mode is 0, this one will be incremented and it will no longer check for any of these other conditions. Similarly, if candidate 3 receives a vote and candidate 4 also receives a valid vote at the same time, the if else if state will reach else if first of candidate 3, and then it will increment candidate 3's vote received and not candidate 4's. Our third module is the mode control module. It is used for the lighting up the LEDs of the Z board depending on which mode the Z board is currently in. For this purpose, it takes the input of the clock, reset, and the input mode, because depending on the mode, it will either light up all of the LEDs if it is in mode 0 to indicate that the vote has been cast, or it will light up the LEDs in a binary manner to indicate how many votes each candidate has in mode 1, which is the tallying mode. It also takes in the input of valid vote casted, which is essentially if a vote has been cast to any of the candidate and it is valid, then this will be used to help us light up the LEDs in mode 0. It also takes in the input of the number of votes each candidate has gotten in order to display them on the LEDs. It also takes in the input of which candidate's button has been pressed for the purpose of displaying the votes in mode 1. And this output is the output that is sent to the LEDs in order to light them up. For lighting up the LEDs in mode 0, we will use this 31-bit counter to time the amount for which the LEDs will light up. In this always block, if reset is pressed, the counter becomes 0, and then if a valid vote is received, if valid vote casted is high, then the counter increments to 1, and then it will come back around and it will trigger this condition in which the counter is not 0 and the counter is less than 10. So the counter will increment in this loop until it becomes 10. Once the counter has become 10, this condition will no longer be valid and the loop will run again and reach this point in which the counter will become 0. By using the increment of the counter, we will light up the LEDs in this always block. Now in this, when reset is pressed, the LEDs have a 0 value input to them, meaning they will not light up. And in this else block, if our mode is 0, and our counter is greater than 0, then LEDs will have this value input to them. This is a 8-bit hexadecimal value FF. This will light up all of the LEDs, and if the counter greater than 0 condition is no longer satisfied, the LEDs will receive this 00 value, which will turn all of them off, and as such this condition corresponds to this portion of the loop in which the counter is being incremented and is thus greater than 0, as these always blocks are executing in parallel. So once valid vote is casted, the counter becomes incremented to 1, it becomes greater than 0, this condition is satisfied and the LEDs light up. The counter keeps incrementing in this loop until it reaches the value of 10. For that entire time, the LEDs will remain lit up, and then it will trigger this else condition, the counter will become 0, and the second the counter becomes 0, the LEDs will have this value input into them because this condition will become valid and the LEDs will turn off. Alternatively, if our mode is 1, then we will display the number of votes received by each candidate by using this if else if condition. If candidate 1 button press, then the LEDs will be given the value of the number of votes that candidate 1 possesses. Else if candidate 2 button press, then they will receive the value of the candidate 2 button press, and by doing so we will be able to display the number of votes gained by each candidate. Machine is the final module. It is created by combining all of the previous modules into a functioning block. It takes in these various inputs of clock, reset, mode, and these four buttons corresponding to the four candidates, and gives an output to the LEDs. These wires are for interconnecting the modules that we are going to use, and this any valid vote is for indicating when any valid vote has been cast for any candidate by ORing all of these values. Here we create the buttons, or rather the button controls. So button control 1, button control 2, 3, 4, and then we connect these wires, valid vote 1, which is a valid vote for candidate number 1, to button control 1's output, that is the valid vote output, and then we connect the corresponding wires to each of these button controls. And then finally, we take these valid vote wires and then we connect them to the input of the vote logger, which will log whenever a vote has been cast for a candidate, such as candidate 1 vote valid. This is an input of the vote logger and it is connected to the valid vote 1 wire, which is an output of the button control 1, which will indicate that a valid vote has been cast, and as such the counter in the vote logger will be incremented. And these are the outputs of the vote logger. These will pass on the number of votes cast to each candidate to the mode control. As you can see, these are 8 bits, such as the registers we used to tally the votes received by each candidate. And these outputs will then be passed on to the mode control. These are the inputs of the mode control. Candidate 1 vote, candidate 1 vote received is an output from vote logger to the input of the mode control. The mode controls also has input of mode, which will determine how to light up the LEDs in the given conditions. This in mode 0, this valid vote casted will be used to light up all of the LEDs when the vote is cast, to indicate that the vote has been cast. And in mode 1, when the candidate 1 button is pressed, the valid vote of the candidate 1 will be displayed, and similarly when candidate 2 button is pressed, the number of votes of candidate 2 will be displayed, and all of these will be sent to the LED, which is the output of the mode control. This is the test bench that I made for this program. It has various inputs such as the clock, the reset mode, the buttons for the candidates, the wires for the LEDs. This is the instantiation of the voting machine module and the connections to the required inputs. This is the creation of the clock. And finally, we have the test values. Now be sure to run the reset for a sufficient amount of time first in order to initialize all of the register values to zero, otherwise it may cause issues with your output. These are the test values supplied over intervals. And then finally we have this block which is used for running the epwave function of EDA Playground, which is essentially the timing diagram. Now this is the timing diagram for the program. These are the buttons being pressed. These are the votes accumulated by each candidate, the clock, the LEDs, the mode of the voting machine, and the reset button. In the beginning, the reset was made high. Everything has been set to zero in the beginning. So first, button 1 is pressed for a short duration. And because it is for a short duration, no vote is logged. The number of votes of candidate 1 remains 0, and the LEDs also do not light up. Now next, button 1 is pressed for a long duration. This causes the LEDs to light up, you can see here from this value, and then the value of candidate 1's votes is incremented by 1, and the mode, as we can see, is 0, hence the votes are being incremented. Then button 2 is pressed for a long duration. Again, the LEDs light up, and then we see the number of votes of candidate 2 have been incremented by 1, and then both button 2 and button 3 are pressed for a long duration. The LEDs light up, indicating that the vote has been cast, and then, as discussed earlier, because of the hierarchy that exists, number of votes of candidate 2 will be incremented, whereas candidate 3 will still have 0 votes even at this point. And then the mode is shifted to mode 1 here for this duration, and then button 2 is pressed, and the LEDs give us an output of 2, which is the number of votes of candidate 2. As such, it is working properly.